Hello, nice evening, I wish you. Last week I had a crippled infect, but now I'm not the Chinese one, but now I'm happy. I think that's the voice will work. We will have presentations. In some we have three presentations. And we have an experiment you see on the on your perspective on the left side. Eye tracking instrumentation, and we have two others in the Mensa area, so we can make experiments, not with all of you, it's not manageable. We have 20 eye trackers, and I got for software engineering, for programming research from the Federal Republic of Germany, €500,000 to make this research, but it's not... We need a greater transportation to bring 20 eye trackers with us because they have a great suitcase. Code reviews is in our perspective, and we know we have automatic code reviews, but reading code is also an issue in the area of testing, in the area of penetration testing, so it's valid to make research also in reading code and to understand more about this. And the other topic is expertise research. This is an area and discipline which is also in pedagogics and psychology, how to become an expert. And this is a way from a novice to an expert. And we will hear some other insights to this topic from my PhD student, Florian Hauser, and Dr. Kenneth Holmquist. He is also a member in our research team. Dr. Holmquist is the worldwide leading person in the eye tracking technology, and he wrote the worldwide first book, the first essential book about eye tracking. So, and we have students who help us, and their name is Stefan Schreistetter and Nick Shaw. Yes, and I'm ZDP research professor. I'm professor since 20 years, and since 2 years, I'm in the Center of Bavarian Digitalization, I have a special research professorship. And we have also other topics. We are involved, Laboratory for Safe and Secure Systems, a discipline of software engineering is our laboratory. And we are involved in a lot of topics. So in the perspective of software engineering, we work for functional safety, for IT security issues, and programming is also a part of the work area. Yeah, here's a picture from mine in the Alpine area. I love the Alpine area. It's very nice in summertime, also in winter. And I'm also member of member of the advisory board of the Bavarian Cluster of IT Security and Safety. And I also work in the MISRA C++ working group. And you know the other topics, every computer science specialist knows this. Yes, and I also write books and model-based security, safety, and a new book with Peter Sommerlatt about safe and modern C++. Yes, and if we start, we can think about, okay, how to learn programming, how to have assistance by eye tracking for learning, and if you think about learning, learning is a very activating area. And here you see a picture, which is named the School of Athens. Okay, German, English. School of Athens from Raphael. It's in the Vatican Museum in Roma. It's very nice. It's great. And it expresses the active world of and the engagement. You see Platon and Aristoteles and other ones. In Wikipedia, you have a list who is who. This is the spirit we have to learn programming, you learn modern C++, that we have engagement. I return to the point of engagement later. Now, a short look to the time scale. I start with an introduction of expertise research in software engineering, and I will speak about coding guidelines and such stuff. And if I repeat something which is known by all of you, then give me a sign that I repeat not the thing you know. Then Florian Hauser and then Kenneth Holmquist will talk about the eye tracking technology. And afterwards, Florian Hauser gives an insight in first results. We started to use eye tracking for programming education. And we started with C, then we started with simple C++, and modern C++ is on our research agenda for the future. And I explained why we started and what the goal is for the start. And then we have in parallel experiments, online experiments. In Florian, we will tell how this will work. And the other group will do the experiment with paper. We have a printout with paper, and we ask you how you think, how you read code. And there's a theory of facets and facades, and also the attention will be figured out. We show you how it works. Yes, and then we think at 10 in the night about it, we will close the session. So if I start to speak about coding, and we have to think also about errors. And you can discuss the numbers in the right column with very much of criticism. And this work is from 1997. And here we have different maturity models. And what we show is we have remaining faults in source in 1,000 lines of source code. We have remaining faults. And also you can discuss which programming language. If I use Haskell, this could be a better result compared to C++ or to Java. If you have eloquent languages like C++ or Java, you need more lines of code as you have poor functional programming as in Haskell. So this is a result of, established languages. And the answer is what can we do? We can reduce faults by a better process. And here is code review, one tool we can use. And if we have physics and entropy, we know zero defects is not possible. I know a semiconductor company in Germany, and they have management banner, zero defects. They make matter, but matter has also defects because of physics and entropy. And so it's not a wonder that we have in source code also defects. We can reduce them, and we can handle them by architecture. And who is working in safety areas from you? Okay, a small group. But you know, we can make fail-safe architectures, we can make fault-tolerant architectures, and we can handle in safety systems systematic faults, remaining faults in source code. So now I searched for numbers. My belief was, it was several years ago, that there could be a factor of 1,000 better. Time goes and we make better processes, we have agile, we have some other things, we have type-based languages. So my still hope was there is a great jump, but I was was very surprised, 2012 paper, and it's also with established languages. And you see, we don't discuss the numbers in detail, and also the compared process models not, but we see we are in the area of kilo lines of code. So no great change. So the situation is as it was. So, okay, if we think about writing safe source code, there will be a help to bring terms together, to have a common understanding. And this model is the model of dependability. So, there's a very good paper. If you think about writing safe and secure code, a paper from Jean-Claude Labrie, who was professor in Toulouse. Now, 2 years ago, he died, but he did a very good taxonomy, and he ordered the terms. We know the terms of non-functional requirements or quality requirements, but he ordered this, and dependability comprises safety, it comprises security, and we have the availability, the safety, the confidentiality, the integrity, the maintainability. So a lot of terms we have, and there are also, there's a Japanese programming guideline I show you later, the citation, say order guidelines along non-functional requirements. This is the first guideline I saw with this order of guideline rules. So MISRA and so on, they order about the content of language Yes. And okay, this was the next. This was a step, and the next step is which errors can happen in programming. And we did a brainstorming also in my team, and we also used literature. And you know, you have style errors if you programming style. I have semantic errors. I can invalid program logic, but these semantic errors are correlated a little bit, I think, to logical errors because unintended or undesired output. We have also we have syntax error. The compiler helps us. Lexical errors. The compiler helps us. Design errors could be very complicated. And we have also compiler errors. The compiler itself could be wrong. So then I ordered, we ordered in the teams the errors which can happen on this two-axis system. We have on the right side, the program is running, we have runtime, we can do dynamic tests, or we have runtime errors. Or we have on the other side, design time, we have compile time, and we have reviews, compile time errors or reviews. And the idea to reduce costs is to find errors more and more on the left side. And here will future C++ help us with a very good type system, because the checks will be done at compile time, and we have here an action, so it's the area of action, which is cheaper compared to a software we have in the runtime. And we ordered these topics. Yes. And process improvement will be a help for this. Yes, and if we go a little bit along the way of better programming, there is from Winters a nice philosophy of Google Coding Guidelines 2014 in CPPCon. Code is going to live along and to be read many times. We choose explicitly to optimize for the reader. It's a very nice sentence, which gives us a good, motivation. Yeah, and what will we do? We want to use a coding guideline to avoid unsafe and unsecure language constructs, and we want to have a readable, maintainable code. We use a style guideline. Yeah, and what can happen in C? It's a C perspective. We have the situation that the compiler doesn't do what the programmer expects. We have in the Arnix a list of, defined, but of many areas. We have compiler. The compiler contains errors we discussed before, and we have runtime errors in C because C is a very weak language. Then we have the MISRA guidelines and categorization of rules, and MISRA is now in the MISRA 2012 standard for C. And the idea is to use a safe language subset. So, and now I searched for C++, and we have a lot of guidelines. MISRA is C++ is very old, but this time, this is the area in which the automotive industry lives. The industry I have in Regensburg, we do a lot of research. They are not in modern C++. But I see the new stuff with artificial intelligence. These guys use modern C++, but the old-fashioned automotive industry is 10 years behind. This is the experience. But I think 2020 or 2021, there will be a new MISRA guideline. We have last year the edition of AUTOSAR C++ guideline, which has an influence to MISRA. We have the high integrity C++, HIC++, you will find in the internet. It's a very good guideline set. In difference to MISRA, they give a comparison between good example and bad example, compliant code, not non-compliant code. This is also done by the CERT guidelines. And here's your Japanese guideline, IPA, you can also acquire by the internet, and they have ordered the guideline by non-functional requirements. Then we have Lockheed Martin, it's also 2005, very old, and we have the very modern C++ core guideline. It's very interesting, and we have Herb Sutter, it's also 2005. Yes, the situation in MISRA is that we have unspecified, undefined, and implementation-specific behaviors. This is the focus of MISRA coding guidelines. And what does this mean? We have language constructs that must compile successfully, but in which the compiler writer has some freedom. So different compilers have different results. For example, parameter evaluation in function calls from left to right or from right to left. This is an old topic we have, if we have side effects in the parameter evaluation. We have undefined behavior. The compiler writer is not obliged to write error messages, invalid parameters to function. And we have implementation-defined behavior, and this is discussed. There is an idea that the compiler manufacturer has to describe them, the programmer has to describe them with comments. But on the other side, there is a rule to avoid all three categories of insecurity and unsafety. Yeah, and then I did a picture about C, and if you see under the ocean, there are a lot of topics in C which are complicated, which are dangerous, and if I do control loops and only use inflowed character, I have the chance in C to be safe, but if I do other things, I have great dangers. And we have the topics undefined, unspecified, implementation defined. We have dangerous type conversion, no type system. We have integral promotion. I say this is a feeling of a data type. If you make a conversion from a short or character as int, and you have then the int type, is a type change. So this is integral promotion. It's an inconsistency in C, but it was wanted in former times by the compiler writer because they write for a microcontroller, and you have a in the registers you have a width of bit, and therefore it does not make a problem for in their view, but in real it's a problem. We have function pointer, we have arrays, type safety is a topic, yes. Yeah, if I make a look in a comparison to C++, and I cite Peter Sommerlath, he did this comparison 2019, and I compare the type and the type system, but I don't do this now because we want to come to eye tracking. But we see that C++ has more type safety. It's more safe as C is. And in C, I need a complete understanding of memory. This I also need in C++, but I have a help by the means of C++. And if I show it here with compile time computation, with values, with statements, with types, with templates, I see C++ is a very strong language compared to C. And this is also motivation for the automotive industry. I have a lot of connection to make a change. Yes, and if we now make the picture, we see with these enumerated topics, we have the chance, and with type evaluation at compile time, that C++ is a safe language, and the topics we have in the inside the water, we have also to handle and keep in mind, but we have assistance by the green layers. So, yes. And if we take this knowledge, we can say C is in this area. So, okay, it's a first discussion, but C++ did a change from this area to this with the ID, let the compiler do the work with compile time programming. This is for the future. So, now go 10 years back, 15 years back, what does the normative regulation say? The normative regulation says, don't you see in safety critical systems, safety integrity level describes the level of safety. If I have high safety demands, I have a high level, not recommended. C is not recommended, but C with a subset is recommended. There was not C++ enumerated in this norm, but in the new norm, there is the recommendation, use programming languages with a strong type system. This is a very good message for C++. And if you take also a further look in IEC 61508/3, this is a standard norm for safety. The standard norm for functional safety, you see, use a coding standard, highly recommended. And they say some other topics which are more detailed explained in guideline. We have the situation that we have to write a company C guideline, for example, if we do it for C, and we have MISRA C as core, and we have the standard, and you see in this diagram how it fits. In C++, we have the current world that we have a different situation. We have MISRA C++ guideline 2008, and we have a standard 2017. There's a great difference. And new MISRA C is currently at work. So this is the area of coding guideline I presented very short, the focus, the intention. And now this question is, how to educate coding guideline? And how to train it in the company, and how to help the development process to be better. And which learning arrangements are appropriate? So this is now a jump in philosophy and didactics, pedagogics, and software engineering is also a discipline which has not only hard stuff of computer science, it has also the question how to bring a team dynamic to life. And one topic is constructivism. Constructivism is a philosophy, and constructivism says it does not make sense that I make a presentation here. You hear and I speak. And the theory says you learn very less if one is in front and you hear. You have to do something. And you do the things, what you do, with your experience, with your background and your history. So the constructivism arrangements gives us a tool that we take everybody from his current situation to take the next step. Self-controlled learning is an IT that I control my steps. Inverted classroom is one IT that we do a lot of stuff at our desk with our team. Inside discussion and the meeting, the workshop, the presentation collects the issues. And we have the idea of active learning. Peer instruction is one example, the two persons are work together. For example, pair programming is also peer instruction. And active learning, I do something. So, and now I say what could be a solution. A solution could be a learn management system. A system which gives us guidance, which steers our process of learning coding guidelines. And I show you the Capella approach. This is a paper from my team, 2017. We did research with an Israel university, with two Israel universities. And what we mean is to present different content. And what you see is that a learner can go different paths with different contents. So, what we want to do is to present guideline stuff in different forms, not only by text, also by explorations, experiments, by examples, by explanation, text videos, by exposure. So, some different presentation of issues. What happens is that learners go individual paths through the content. And here I make a short jump. What we now want to do is, when learners go different paths through the content, we want to give them assistance. Only now the concrete situation of code review. In the concrete situation of code review, the programmer reads primary and secondary artifacts, for example, source code, diagrams, requirements, and we collect with eye tracking data of attention. We collect data during the review process about the time you read a statement, what is the next statement you read, and we collect this data. And this is not the end. And we are currently in this phase, in this analysis phase of GAZE data, of attention data collection. And this data, we need to build a learn management system. We need a database for future to give in the situation the correct information to the programmer, the information he needs. And this is the feedback loop. This was in it. This is a feedback loop. Adaptive feedback. We can give feedback as augmented reality, as text information, as video, as example, on the base of eye tracking experiments on this base of research data. And therefore, we start now with this kind of experiments. And to realize this, we have I have not the time to speak about this. I have this slide with me. But this is a workflow of, we don't speak about the details. This is a workflow for such a learn management system. And eye tracking is here in the measurement area. We measure how the programmer works with this learning content, with this program example, with the problems in the program. And then we have to establish the database. And with this database knowledge, we can arrange the right feedback. Yes. Okay. This is a story about eye tracking and our great vision we have to build learn management systems and also assistance systems for the software engineering process. We see this result not only for university education, we see it also for a development process. And my last citation is from Seneca, and Seneca told us, we have not too less time in this world, we have enough time if we do the right things. Okay. This was my presentation, and we have now a change.